Good afternoon. My name is Alexis Gurganius, and I'm the speakers director of the William F. Buckley Jr. Program at Yale. I hope everyone has enjoyed the preceding panels.
Hey guys.
And our final panel today will focus on the future of the American party system in the post-2016 era. I have the pleasure of introducing our moderator for today's panel. Mr. William F.B. O'Reilly is a New York-based political and corporate communication strategist and a twice-weekly columnist for Newsday. He was the founding partner at NLO Strategies, a leading Republican consulting firm, and executive vice president at its corporate partner, Nicholas and Lenz Communications. Mr. O'Reilly has run strategic communication campaigns in dozens of states around the country and has served as spokesman for conservative candidates and causes in his 25-year career. Bill was a founding partner at O'Reilly Strategic Communications, which he sold in 2008, and a press officer in the New York State Senate and the New York City Council. He is a board member of the American Association of Political Consultants and a partner at the November team. After the discussion, we will have time for questions. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our moderator, Mr. William F.B. O'Reilly.
Thanks, everybody. So we're going to be talking about the future of the political party system, which is a pretty broad topic. But we've got three people who couldn't be better to speak to it. They're all well-known. If anyone doesn't know our three panelists, I assure you that they've earned their seat here today. Margaret Hoover is here, who is you'll see Margaret on CNN. She's a CNN contributor, also a best-selling author, and the president of the American
Unity Fund,
exactly, the Unity Fund, which is actually helping one of my candidates right now, so thank you. Ramesh Ponnuru is a senior editor at National Review and also a Bloomberg columnist as well now. And James Taranto, I think you all know, is the editor of Best of the Web and on the Wall Street Journal editorial board. So we've got some very good talent up here to talk to it. The question I really want to ask today is whether you all think that Reince Priebus should be hung, and if so, by what grade of rope? But I'm gonna defer.
Not to be pedantic, but you're supposed to say hanged.
Excuse me. I think we'll just launch each of you. I was going to ask if you could speak about 10 minutes on where you see the party structure, how you see both parties moving forward in the next, say not just 4 years, but let's say 8 years, or anything else you want to interject on. There's a lot to talk about. So why don't we start with you, James, and we'll work down the table and back up.
Well, thank you. I attended both political conventions this year. I covered them for my column, as I've done every presidential election year since 2004, and I was following presidential politics for several cycles before that. And this year's conventions were different. They were interesting. And what was interesting about them was that both parties were very clearly divided. The emblematic example of this was the reception that the two runners-up received at the conventions during their primetime speeches. Both Ted Cruz and Bernie Sanders got booed. Now, they got booed for opposite reasons. Cruz got booed because he refused to endorse the party's nominee. Sanders got booed because he endorsed the party's nominee. But even though the former candidates were doing different things to get booed, I think the booing suggests a certain commonality in the party, which is that that both parties are quite bitterly and somewhat openly divided. The Democrats were actually more openly divided, I thought, in my observations from 4 days in Cleveland and 4 days in Philadelphia. There were these big protests in the streets. There were very angry people standing right outside the convention perimeter, heckling people as they were walking in. At one point, I think they shut down the subway station. People had to walk a mile through 95-degree temperatures to get to the convention site. And Mrs. Clinton's speech was interrupted. I didn't keep count, but I would say at least a dozen times by hecklers. If you were watching at home, that was, you could tell, because there were these oddly timed chants of Hillary, Hillary. Those were the Hillary delegates shouting down the hecklers. And Leon Panetta was savagely and repeatedly booed. Now, I don't mean to suggest that the Democrats are more divided than the Republicans. I don't think they are. I think that the Democrats just tend to be more rambunctious than Republicans. Most of the Republicans who objected to the party's nominee simply stayed away from the convention, including John Kasich, the governor of the state, and Jeb Bush. So I think the Republicans are more divided. Certainly, in the past 3 months, we've seen the Democrats both much more effectively suppress their divisions and more effectively exploit the other party's divisions than the Republicans have, if polls are to be believed, and I sort of think they are. So what's the future of the party system in America? Well, I think that we will continue to have a two-party system because it's almost built into our constitutional structure. Probably the two parties will be called the Democrats and the Republicans and will be continuous with the current parties, although that doesn't necessarily have to be so. But I think that the divisions that we've seen in the parties this year suggest ways in which the coalitions that make up the two parties could change in coming years. Now, let me just explain a little bit why I think that a two-party system is virtually a necessity based on our constitutional structure. The previous panel talked a bit about experience in other countries, and all of the countries that were cited are countries that have parliamentary systems. Well, in a parliamentary system, you can have a small party. You could have a party like the Libertarians or the Greens here, or whatever Evan McMullen's party is going to be called, and it can win a few seats in parliament, and then if nobody has a majority of seats, the small parties have a lot of power because they can negotiate with the plurality party to become part of a coalition, or even with a minority party that doesn't win the plurality. America is different because of our winner-take-all presidency and the need for a majority in the Electoral College. So it's very difficult to wage any kind of serious third-party candidacy for the presidency. I think the only time it's ever come close to being done is in 1912 when Teddy Roosevelt split off from the Republicans and actually finished second, won a bunch of states. William Howard Taft, the Republican incumbent, won two states. Interestingly, one was Utah. The other was Vermont. But I think perhaps the most telling fact is that since 1856, the first year in which we had the Democrats and the Republicans as our two major parties, no party has ever won electoral votes, apart from the Democrats and Republicans, in more than one election, with the qualified exception of the Populist Party, whose candidate John Weaver won several states in 1892, and then its candidate William Jennings Bryan won a bunch of states in 1896, but Bryan, of course, was also the nominee of the Democratic Party, which illustrates the point. If you want to have political power, as opposed to just make an ideological statement like, say, the Libertarians, you align yourself with one of the major parties because that way you have a possibility of winning the presidency. The other alternative to a two-party system or a multi-party system might be a one-party system. We had a one-party system for a while, for a very short period. In 1820, James Monroe won re-election by 231 electoral votes to one, and the guy who got the one vote, John Quincy Adams, was from the same party, what was then called the Republican Party, and political scientists now call it the Democratic Republican Party. Well, then what happens? You get 1824. The one party, the Democratic Republican Party, is split four ways. John Quincy Adams has a minority of both popular and electoral vote. The vote is thrown to the House. He reaches a deal with Henry Clay and is elected by the House. Andrew Jackson, who won the plurality in both popular and electoral votes, makes a stink for the next 4 years. And by that point, we have a two-party system. The Democrats and were for that one cycle in 1828 called the National Republican Party. So we very quickly got to a two-party system, and I think the same thing would happen consider this thought experiment. Suppose that on the 4th of July there was, let's say, a rapture, and only all Democrats, but only Democrats, were raptured. They suddenly disappeared off the face of the earth. It's just a thought experiment, folks. What do you suppose would have happened to the Republican Party? I think what would have happened is the Republican Party would have split in two. The never Trump people, like the man who sat in this seat in the earlier panel, Bill Kristol, I think would have had a very easy time getting together a new party to stand for traditional Republican principles. And so you'd have the Trump Party and the anti-Trump Party. and they would go at it, and it would be, you'd have a two-party system. Try the thought experiment the other way. Suppose all Republicans were raptured, and it was just Democrats and independents left. I think you'd see the same thing. The Bernie Sanders people would have split off, and formed their own party, and it would have been, you know, center-left versus socialist. The lesson of this thought experiment is that what holds the parties together, in spite of their divisions, to the extent that the parties are held together, is antagonism for the other party. And so I think there is a natural tendency toward a two-party system play out regardless of what happens with these particular parties. Now, one can imagine a situation in which one or the other party, most likely the party that loses this presidential election, which means most likely the Republicans, can't get its act together, completely disintegrates, and something else, some other party develops. Perhaps the Libertarians emerge as a sort of mainstream party of fiscal conservatives and social liberals. Although, in order for that to work, by definition, the Democrats have to turn into the party of social conservatism. The reason I say by definition is because if you have two parties and they're both social liberal parties, that means the issue is no longer being contested. The social liberalism no longer distinguishes the remaining party. But I think it's unlikely to happen. I think it's much more likely that inertia will prevail and the two parties will continue to be the Democratic and Republican parties. But they will come to look somewhat different from the way they look now, as in fact they have they've been doing for some time. But the divisions in the party primaries reveal some of the ways in which some of the potential fault lines, potential ways in which the parties might realign themselves. So looking at the Republican Party, Donald Trump, as Bill Kristol pointed out, has taken orthodox Republican positions on some questions, on taxes, on most of the social issues, including guns, but excluding gay rights, although I think that's an issue in which public opinion has shifted so far to the left that it's probably not going to be much of a contested issue between the two parties for very much longer. I would add crime and education to the list. But in other areas, he's really made a challenge to Republican orthodoxy. On trade and immigration, which true, those are questions on which the party has been divided for some time. On entitlements, where he's taken the position that I don't want to touch Social Security or Medicare, which seems to me to be a fiscally reckless but politically prudent position to take. And I think the one that is most underappreciated is foreign policy. And I'll tell you a story about the primaries that really brought this home to me. I think it was in February, there was a debate in South Carolina in which Trump just lashed out at Jeb Bush about Iraq and said, your brother lied us into war. He claimed there were weapons of mass destruction. That wasn't true, and so on and so forth. And I was watching this debate live, and I hardly noticed this. And the reason I hardly noticed this, I realized later, was I was already inured to Trump saying outrageous things during the debates. And I was also inured to the particular outrageous thing that he was saying about, you know, George W. Bush lied us into Iraq, because we've heard it so much from the left over the past dozen years or so. And so it didn't strike me as anything all that unusual until a few days later I was talking to some fellow conservative journalists who were quite strongly offended by this, and I realized, oh yeah, they're right. It was out of place at a Republican debate, which you would expect to be a safe space from that sort of comment. And it really was an outrageous thing to say. Whatever you may say about Iraq, I think the idea that that Bush lied to get us into the war is preposterous. They were completely right. But then of course Trump went on to win the South Carolina primary decisively. So that was not disqualifying, and it occurred to me that he was probably, in his general sentiment, if not in his exact words, speaking for a lot of Republicans who kind of feel like the Iraq War not only was a mistake, but was a mistake that cost them dearly in terms of what they believed in. Because if we hadn't had the Iraq War, and if it hadn't gone bad in 2004 to 2006 or 7, would Barack Obama have been elected? Might we not have had Obamacare and all of the other things that Republicans find so frustrating, if not for the Iraq War? And Trump has actually taken a position on Iraq that seems to me to be, I mean, it's basically the position I came around to a few years ago, which is going in was a mistake and getting out was a mistake. And Trump is about the only one who's saying all those things. So the idea that the Republicans were going to nominate Jeb Bush, who couldn't even come up with an answer to the question, knowing what you know now, would you go in retrospect looks rather ridiculous. So I think Republicans are going to have a lot to rethink if as everyone assumes they lose the election. These are some of the things they may rethink. It may lead to a certain reshuffling of priorities. I noticed some of the neoconservatives who are more interventionist on foreign policy are now endorsing Mrs. Clinton. Some of the free trade people are moving over toward the Democrats. The Democrats also have areas in which divisions could drive people away. Trade is a big issue for them as well. I noticed at the Democratic convention, the most common sign I saw carried by Bernie Sanders supporters was the words TPP with a circle, red circle, and a cross through it. And of course, Mrs. Clinton has dealt with a lot of those divisions by adjusting her own positions. Race could be a dividing point for Democrats. Bill Galston talked about the minority vote, which has been rather overwhelmingly Democratic, but not all minority groups necessarily have a confluence of interests. For example, the Democrats are the party of racial preferences in college admissions, which benefit blacks and Hispanics, but work against the interests of Asian Americans. It's not clear that open immigration is in the interests of black Americans. So there are a lot of areas where there are potential for Democrats to lose voters as well. And I suppose we need to consider the possibility of a Trump victory. Granted, this is unlikely, but I checked election betting odds and 538.com this morning. They both put the odds of a Trump victory at 18.7%.
That was before the emails.
Right, which is a little bit better than 1 in 6. Now, 1 in 6 is not great odds, but on the other hand, 1 in 6 are the odds if you throw a pair of dice that you'll throw a 7, which is the most common roll. So it's not impossible. And on the train up from New York, I checked election betting odds again, and Trump's odds had gone up to 23%, almost 1 in 4. We'll see if that lasts through the evening. I suspect if Donald Trump has ever been recorded on tape uttering a racial slur, we're going to know about it within the next 2 or 3 hours. But in the unlikely event that Trump wins, I think the Democrats are going to have to rethink things a lot sooner than the Republicans are, and it may be more difficult for them because it will be a sudden trauma, in a way, the Republican trauma has been more gradual over the past year and a half or so. Thanks.
Thanks, James. So I agree with James on the sort of the two-party system. I don't think that's in doubt or really in question. I, as a Republican, don't spend a lot of time thinking about the future of the Democratic Party, especially in the context of sort of this election that we're about to undergo. So presuming that the odds makers we may have Anthony Weiner to thank yet, it seems, if you're reading your alerts. My guess is along the lines of the odds makers, which is that that Hillary Clinton becomes the next president, and the Republican Party has an opportunity to really rethink and reimagine its future. And that's what I sort of spend more of my time thinking about. So in the context of this discussion, I've thought about really what happens to the Republican Party in a post-Trump era. And I think there's sort of two broad possibilities in terms of how Republicans and how political operatives and the sort of political coalitions and even sort of the intellectual groups deal with a post-Trump experience. And I think one of them, which may seem far-fetched, but I think is entirely possible, I can almost see it happening and beginning to happen now, is that we treat this experience as a complete aberration. Like, nothing to see here, folks. Nothing going on here. We just sort of revert back to the model that we have used in previous elections really for the last 30 years, which is sort of a, you know, orthodox conservative approach. If you're socially conservative, fiscally conservative, and sort of internationalist, have an internationalist foreign policy, like, that's the formula. That's how we're going to win again. Never mind what just happened. It was a hiccup. And then there's, you know, this hope that I have, and I think that many of us have, that we have to sort of acknowledge what happened here and try to understand it in the context of also a set of national elections where the Republican Party has one time in the last six national elections fielded a conservative candidate that has won a national election. We're about to have a seventh national election, not with a conservative in it, but a Republican, where we're also going to lose. And we need to think about winning. And we need to think about what it takes to win. And there is, you know, sort of in the vein of Buckley, you know, an intellectual framework, an architecture that is really important that we need to, I think, rethink. But then there's also sort of basic politics, right? And, you know, even just looking at 2012, right, when Mitt Romney won, of any GOP challenging an incumbent president, he won 59% of the white vote, which is more than any candidate previously. And every subgroup of white voters, he won men and women and young and old and Protestant and Catholic. And fundamentally, we know that the problem that we're having in terms of garnering new voters is that our voters are, they're a shrinking share of the electorate, right? White voters, rural voters, older voters all vote Republican, and there just aren't enough of them for us to win. And millennials and minorities and single women and all these other coalition groups are voting Democrat, and we need more of them. We can't win elections by grabbing a larger piece of a shrinking pie. And so that is something that as we think through what the intellectual framework is going to be, we need to think about sort of intellectual coalitions, but also political coalitions. And that was, I think, the genius of the founder of this forum, is that, you know, the modern American conservative movement was not just a set of ideas, but it was also a coalition that could win politically. And, you know, I have a lot of sympathy for Ramesh and for Ross Douthat and Raihan and the guys who have been talking about and really predicting you know, part of this phenomenon that we have now this time, which is that white working class voters have really finally rebelled against the elites in this party. And I think that as we think through a sort of philosophical framework for sort of a reform conservatism, I think you can, and my hope is that we can sort of square the circle. We can integrate the concerns of this base of the Republican Party, the economic, like real economic grievances, by having sort of a reform conservatism that addresses lethargic economic growth, that addresses what Democrats call inequality and we call sort of the want for more social mobility, that can prepare workers for a skills-based economy, and that has a sincere appeal to minorities and a sincere appeal to women voters, and while still having a posture that is engaging the world. So, you know, I think the ideas of our coalition have been largely right, I think our approaches have been ineffective, and I think we haven't succeeded in building and retaining a coalition that can win politically. So that's sort of the harmonizing of those two bodies is, I think, where we need to go on the Republican side.
Great. So it seems to me that it's easy already to forget that even before Trump, there was a lot of attention to intra-Republican divisions and splits in the preceding years before Trump came down his escalator. And it's just that was the split between what one might call the kind of party establishment and the Tea Partiers. That was this division that dominated a lot of the primaries in the Senate in 2010 and 2012 and in 2014. And it seems to me that we now, I think, have a three-way split in the party, where you've got the Tea Partiers and the establishment folks, but you've also now got this third group, which one might call working class nationalists, who didn't find either of those two factions and their kind of arcane theological disputes all that compelling. This third group, the working class nationalist group, it has always been part of the Republican Party, but it's been an increasingly important share of the Republican vote, and it had never been really organized and activated and made self-conscious until this election. And it's an open question as to whether it survives, because as I think a couple of people have mentioned, there doesn't seem to be a kind of second layer of Trumpism. It's just Trump. There have only been a couple people who've tried to run kind of Trumpite campaigns in the Republican primaries. The guy whose name I already forget that Rubio crushed in his primary, the guy that that Paul Ryan crushed in his primary. The ones who've, so very few have even attempted it, and those who have attempted it have generally failed pretty dismally. So what do Republicans do about this third group? It seems to me that I'm basically seeing three approaches take shape. One is just ignore it. Just pretend this election didn't happen. You know, like I think soap operas do this sometimes. They just erase a season. I think a lot of Republicans are going to be tempted to do that. They're going to say this was a fluke. It's because you had too many candidates. You had the celebrity. You had the media, which, you know, like one of my Bloomberg colleagues says that CNN decided to cover the Trump campaign like a missing plane. This is a black swan event. Won't happen again. So let's go to January 2017, and we're going to continue to have a Democratic president facing off against possibly a Republican Congress. It's entirely possible that the lineup of the House leadership stays exactly where it is, that the lineup of the Senate leadership stays exactly what it is, that Reince Priebus stays, contrary to your wishes, at the RNC and is not, you know, in front of a firing squad or whatever it was. But we just carry on business as usual. I think that's going to be a very strong tendency. I think it should be resisted, but I think that is certainly going to happen. A second possibility, which I hear from what I would describe as some of the more excitable anti-Trump conservatives, is these Trump voters are they have to be purged. They have to, like, if you read Jamie Kirchick, who I like in a lot of, but it's like, these people have to be held to account. Well, this is a democracy, and we don't hold voters to account for making lousy choices, except insofar as they get bad governance as a natural consequence of making lousy political choices. When you hear people, some of the people around Evan McMullen are talking about we have to start a new party because this Republican Party is just too corrupt and compromised. Look, if you want to start a new non-liberal party that is capable of contesting elections and and actually achieving power, guess what? It's going to include religious conservatives. It's going to include working class nationalists. It's going to include all of the same people. It's going to have the same tensions, the same problems, and the same dysfunctions. So you either solve this problem within the Republican Party, or you start a new party and you've got the exact same problem and you've got to solve it anyway. So it just seems like magical thinking. I read other folks, again, people I'm agree with on a lot of things, including a lot of things about Donald Trump, and they say, well, we need to trade voters. You know, we're going to get rid of these bigoted Trump voters and bring in all these other new voters. Well, let me let me hear a little bit more about step two before we do this. You know, if you have a plan for getting rid of X number of voters, I really want to see how you're getting X plus one voters to come in. And it doesn't seem like there are a lot of great trading opportunities. I mean, look, it's not as though the Democratic Party is going to move right on cultural issues in order to attract some of these working class voters. It doesn't seem to be moving right on fiscal issues to make some of these upper middle class voters who may be defecting to Clinton this time stick around. I mean, everything it seems to be doing is moving in the other direction on both of those issues. It wants to expand entitlements rather than reform them. It wants to raise the minimum wage to, you know, a pretty high level. It wants to create a bunch of new free benefit programs. I just don't see, you know, I think you've got a pretty strongly liberal coalition here, and there's just a natural opposition to it that can either be unified and made more effective, or you're just going to have that liberal majority govern, which seems to be what we're doing right now. And this leads me to, of course, my preferred option, the third option, which is you find a way to accommodate this group of working class nationalists. You don't pander to every misguided thought or view that they have, but you try to figure out when they have legitimate grievances, if you can responsibly address them, and you stitch these three groups, you know, the Tea Partiers, the working class nationalists, the establishment, and establishment-oriented voters, you stitch them into a coalition, and then you try to reach beyond those three, because they're not enough, as you're pointing out. It doesn't add up to a majority of the public. And I think that when I talk about accommodation, that has to include a couple of different things, some of them rhetorical, some of them programmatic. I think conservatives need to stop kidding themselves that the Republican coalition is made up of people who all care deeply about the corporate tax rate, and find the mention of Ronald Reagan's name immediately compelling as a reason for action. I think I think a lot of conservatives fooled themselves into thinking that you just had to there's a kind of incantation that you had to perform where you said, look, I'm a conservative, I'm the most conservative of them all, I believe in all 10 points of the conservative dogma, and then this coalition would just sort of leap into place. And I think it's now been made clear that that's not the case even inside the Republican Party, let alone with the electorate at large. One thought on the primaries, thinking in terms of how do you unify a party that is split, it does seem to me that, with keeping in mind the danger of overreacting to one problematic election result, it does seem to me that the primary process does not sufficiently reward candidates for having a breadth of support among different types of Republicans. I don't think that states should be granting 100% of their delegates to the person who wins the plurality, you know, with 35%. I think it makes sense maybe if somebody gets 51%, they get 100% of the delegates. But I think the rule should be changed to not allow what happened in South Carolina, for example, to recur. And I think that some states should probably also have some kind of preferential element to the balloting so that there's something like an instant runoff. I don't think every state should do that. I don't think that you want a process that is built to create somebody who's everybody's second choice. You do want somebody who actually has some passionate supporters, but I think you need some kind of mechanism that not only rewards people, that rewards people who build that breadth of support and then encourages them to go about building that breadth of support by unifying the party. Look, I mean, the primaries are supposed to yield a candidate who, among other things, can unify the party. The last four presidential elections, the Republican nominee has gotten 90% or more of the Republican vote. And, of course, three of those four times, the Republicans lost the popular vote anyway. It seems to me during the later stages of the primaries, Trump was complaining that it was going to be stolen from him because he was going to potentially have a plurality of the delegates. He'd be the plurality winner of the votes, but he wouldn't necessarily be the nominee. The problem actually with the process seems to me isn't the one that he suggested, that the bar for getting the nomination was too high, is that it's too low, that we should actually have something that makes it possible to have somebody with supermajority support be the nominee in the future.
Thank you. I'm going to ask one question and then turn it over to you so we have plenty of time to ask questions. I thought about the RNC did a forensic deep dive after 2012, and the determination was that the Republican Party, to ensure its survival, would do greater outreach to women and to Hispanics in particular. That didn't work too well. But, you know, being a Republican and conservative, we try and be optimistic. Did anything good happen of this year? Is there a pony in there somewhere? What can we latch on to from this year that's of benefit? Ooh. Margaret?
Yeah, I mean, at the fear, I mean, I sort of at the risk of offending, I think one of the sort of main, as we begin to rethink a GOP that can win politically, after in this sort of post-Trump era, and what needs to be done. Certainly, the 2012 RNC autopsy report diagnosed that there aren't enough white people to keep winning these elections, and we need to build coalitions, we need to reach out to women, we need to reach out to Hispanics, we need to reach out to millennials, all these groups that the Republican Party and their nominees have alienated and made to feel disenfranchised. Certainly all that's true, but you know, one of the things that the memes that's happened, especially if you're a Republican candidate, you would go around and you'd meet with donors and you'd meet with sort of conservative intellectuals and sort of parts of what has become the modern American conservative movement, and you would hear that you had to have sort of a straitjacket set of policy prescription, like policy positions on economics, related to taxes, on social issues, related to values, voters, interests, on foreign policy, and as a Republican, you simply can't win if you don't have, you know, these positions. And I think what became abundantly clear through the course of this primary is that isn't true, right? Donald Trump won evangelicals in the South. Again, evangelicals split. You had college-educated evangelicals who went to church every week voting for Ted Cruz, and you had non-college-educated evangelicals that don't go to church voting for Donald Trump. But there was this fallacy that if you were a values voter, you would vote for the sort of arch-conservative or socially conservative candidate, and that turns out not to be true. And if that's not true, right, and what we also learned is that, you know, you're right, Ramesh, like maybe not every Republican voter in the primaries for the last 30 years actually cared about the corporate tax rate. You know, there are other issues that are propelling Republican primary voters to the polls. And so if anything was sort of exposed or revealed in this process, I think it was some of the mythology that we were telling ourselves that actually put us in a bit of a straitjacket, and I think prevented us in some ways from being able to field candidates that could actually reach beyond the traditional Republican voter in a general election.
I just wanted to say something about that autopsy, because there were some perfectly legitimate points about, you know, improving the get-out-the-vote operation for the Republicans, reaching out to non-whites, all kinds of things. But it seems to me that there was a huge blind spot in that autopsy, which is that I took the message of that autopsy to be, if we take these issues that have been distracting people from our core economic message, things like immigration, same-sex marriage, Todd Akin, if you get rid of those distractions, that great economic message of ours will prevail over everything. And maybe it's not such a great economic message, actually. And maybe if you are seen as the party that is exclusively about catering to the interests of rich people and big business, You are going to have a hard time keeping white working class voters in the fold, and you're also going to underperform among Hispanics. You're also going to underperform among single women. You're also going to underperform among young people, because apart from those, maybe each of those groups have some specific issues that are stumbling blocks with them for the Republicans, but it's also true that each of those groups is more economically insecure than the median voter, certainly than the median Republican voter. And so if you don't address that problem, you are still going to be underperforming with all those groups. You're still going to have the problem that any candidate you put up is going to poll worse on the question, does this person care about people like me, a question that has been bedeviling Republicans certainly in the last two presidential elections. So the autopsy for me seemed like a huge missed opportunity and a kind of, but it was symptomatic of the fact that neither the Tea Partiers nor the party establishment actually thought about reformulating our economic agenda.
I'd just like to make a policy point here, which is the corporate tax rate is really high. It's 35%.
We agree with you.
It's higher than any than I, it's the highest or
of course
second
the
highest
Wall Street
in the
Journal
OECD.
Guy has,
right?
We have we also don't have a territorial tax system, so we tax companies on their overseas earnings, which is what creates these incentives for these so-called inversions and so forth. I don't know how to translate this point into a popular political program, but I'm reluctant to say we should just say it's because that's not obvious. We should give up on that question because it is an important question on the merits.
And there a word from the Wall Street Journal editorial board.
Yeah, right.
Who has questions? Gotta be some. Yes, sir.
So I would say before we hit the panic button, a record number of state houses, record number of legislative branches, unbelievable victories in Senate campaigns and House campaigns, an extension of the House majority, even in this election cycle. Look at what Rob Portman is doing. Look at what Pat Toomey is doing. Look at even what Kelly Oates is doing.
Mm. Only one of those three is going to win.
Well, but they're dragging an anchor. Right, they're dragging a big Thanksgiving Day balloon behind them. Shouldn't the question be, what is the difference between the national presidential elections that we've been running, in which we don't seem to have enough people to vote for us, per Ms. Hoover, and the other elections in which we seem to have plenty of people to vote for us? I'd love to hear you comment.
Yeah. Could you add?
Well, it just seems to me that given the geographic dispersion of Republican voters in our country, it is easier for the Republican Party to assemble a House majority than to assemble a Senate majority. And it's easier for them to assemble a Senate majority than it is for them to assemble a presidential majority. Now, you've got the exact reverse problem for the Democrats. Their dominance in cities makes it much harder for them to build a House majority. And now we've got the situation where the demographic differences between the midterm electorate and the presidential electorate maps pretty neatly into the partisan division demographically. And so we have this kind of structural advantage for Republicans in midterm elections and maybe a structural advantage for Democrats at the presidential election. And each side is unhappy, but at the same time, each side is complacent because they're winning some things and they're all going to tell themselves, look, you know, we've got more Republicans elected than any time since, you know, 1928 or 1940s. Pick your time. Yeah, but you can't make the kinds of changes that we need to see unless you actually have the presidency, particularly given the way the presidency has evolved.
It's also interesting that the Republican advantage in congressional elections, and particularly in House elections, started in 1994, just 2 years after the Democratic advantage in presidential elections began. So I think, it's generally the case that the president's party does poorly in midterm elections because there's a backlash or a correction, or call it what you will. And in fact, you go back about 48 years and we've been under divided government with one party controlling at least the House and the other party controlling the presidency for about 10 years of the past 48 years since 1968.
The gentleman at the mic.
Thank you. So, to a certain extent, the message of this autopsy committee was, let's double down on the economic agenda and either leave aside or de-emphasize certain other issues, immigration among them. And it seems like the candidate that we have is one who is not addressing entitlements or decreasing them, or a fiscal conservative in many senses. And given the success that we've seen from that, and given that, to a certain extent, some of the prescriptions that that some of the prescriptions you have for winning in the future involve de-emphasizing fiscal conservatism, is there a path for robust fiscal conservatism to be politically successful in the future? And if not, how doomed are we?
On a scale of 1 to 10, how doomed are we?
I mean, I'm an optimist, right? No, we're not doomed. We're not doomed. Yeah, five.
Well, the one thing Keynes got right is, in the long run, we're all dead.
Look, I'm not sure. I mean, Ramesh, I'd be curious to hear your thoughts, but I'm not convinced that that what this election means is that the conservative party or the center-right party or the Republican Party can't be fiscally conservative anymore. But what it does need to do is rethink its economic policy. It cannot repackage 1984 Ronald Reagan again and again and again. I mean, we've done that over and over and over and over again. And it's, I mean, to the warnings of the reform econs for many years, starting in with, you know, the grand old,
Grand New Party,
that was Raihan and Ross. Mm-hmm. I confuse it with David Frum. But all these folks who have sort of warned us that repackaging Reaganomics is not speaking to a significant plurality of Republican primary voters. So the question is, how do we, I think, responsibly square I think the best impulses of fiscal conservatism, of Paul Ryan's, you know, need and desire to curb the entitlement state, but also be creative about addressing the concerns of white working class Americans who have been left behind and who our policies haven't spoken to.
On entitlements, I think ultimately the choice is going to have to be between reining in benefit growth or raising middle-class taxes. Neither of those is a particularly politically attractive option, but it seems, especially for Republicans, the tax-raising one ought to be less attractive. And so you go with the one that's only mildly unattractive. But I think you've got to make a distinction between the issues that you use to attain a governing majority and the issues that you use your governing majority to attain. There is going to be some overlap, but they're not the same, and you are not going to win a national election emphasizing we're the party that's going to reform entitlements and cut corporate tax rates. That doesn't mean you give up on those causes. I agree that the rate is too damn high, but you have to have something that makes a positive difference in the lives of most people as well, and that, again, it's a matter of program and also of rhetoric. One example I often use, Romney, good man, but his 59-point economic plan from 2012, which I think had 59 points to dissuade people from actually going through them, and there was like a 120-page booklet that accompanied that plan, and that booklet mentioned the word wages exactly twice, and one of those times it was to say that Obama was waging war on coal. And so if all we do is talk about GDP growth and we've lost the basic bread and butter concerns of most people, of course we're not going to win elections.
I would just add on entitlement reform. That is one of the most politically difficult issues there is. Remember, George W. Bush in 2005, after his reelection, said, put out a plan for Social Security reform. Said he was spending his political capital, and very quickly, it was all gone. I mean, the proposal was a lead balloon. I don't think he had any supporters in Congress. And I've heard it argued, and I think this is a credible argument. I'm not sure that I agree, but I think it's a credible and interesting argument that was the turning point. That was when George W. Bush's presidency started going downhill, and not Katrina or Iraq. So it's going to have to be dealt with one way or the other, and the longer we put it off, the more convulsive it's going to be. So I don't have an answer on that one.
Yes, sir. And then we'll come back here.
Thank you for this. As ideal as these prescriptions sound, they're ultimately prescriptions. And I'm left wondering if kind of the autopsy here is that, Trump and this election has split apart, these alliances between these different groups Will there not always be an incentive for a candidate to appeal to just one group? It seems intuitive that at least on the Democratic side, in the future, there's going to be a kind of progressive candidate and a more centrist candidate. And I'm wondering, on the Republican side, if you think that there's always going to be someone who's going to try and appeal to that base, and this ideal kind of breadth that draws on a lot of different groups is possible.
Well, I'm not sure. I think your question may be based on a dubious premise in that Margaret pointed out evangelicals in the South voted for Trump. I don't think it's true that he appealed only to one group. I think he appealed more to certain groups than to others. But if you look at it, my recollection from looking at the exit polls was that his appeal was actually fairly broad. He appealed, he got substantial support from just about every group of Republicans, at least the way they break down the polls.
If you looked at the big wins, New Hampshire, South Carolina, Indiana, he was winning almost every demographic group, although the margin by which he won varied. He tended to do worse among voters who consider themselves very conservative than he did among voters who consider themselves somewhat conservative or voters who consider themselves moderate. And he tended to do worse, not everywhere, but he tended to do worse among evangelicals. Some of the evidence that we have suggests that that he particularly did badly among people who don't just describe themselves as evangelicals but actually go to church. It does seem to me there's a recurring structure to Republican primaries. There tends to usually be splitting on the right that allows, and less splitting among the moderate kind of establishment lane, I guess is the phrase we're all using for these things now. And that usually enables somebody to the left of the party center of gravity to win the nomination, as has happened, happened in every post-Reagan race. What happened this time was that there was splitting among the moderate and establishment voters as well. So it was still the case that the person who the very conservatives wanted, Cruz, didn't win the nomination. That much was just like every other primary. But what was unusual this time was that the party establishment, the moderate and somewhat conservative voters tended to coalesce this time behind somebody who wasn't blessed by the party establishment.
But isn't Trump to the left of the party center? I seem to remember that was the main message of National Review's Against Trump issue.
He's left, he's right, he's below.
I appreciate your question, because what you're suggesting is, there's this sort of third of the Republican Party base that voted for this guy, and isn't that going to be a recurring thing in future presidential primaries? And it very well may be. And the difference, I think, that Ramesh was pointing out is just that, the other two-thirds of the GOP primary electorate might or might not be as divided. And if it is, then you get another person in that model. And if it's not, then I think, the majority could coalesce around somebody else who is sort of more of a centrist or establishment type or a conservative.
Well, I'm curious to the extent that the prescriptions for fixing the Republican Party stem far more from a lack of self-confidence than anything else. I think someone made the point that we can't just keep repackaging Ronald Reagan and hoping it'll work. But it seems to me that that's actually what Trump has done. Also, in terms of healthcare, for the past 8 years, we've had a lot of conservatives saying, well, we need to repeal Obamacare. And then you have Trump come in and say, no, we need to replace Obamacare with this great system. And then if you just look under the hood of what the great system is, it's just getting rid of regulation, which is what the what conservatives have wanted for the past 8 to 16 years anyway. So I'm wondering, to the extent, are Trump's policies actually different from traditional, like, Reagan conservative policies, or are they just a positive expression of those policies? A positive expression of those policies that just seems so alien to us because we haven't been positively expressing why, socially conservative issues are important. To what degree is this a fundamental problem with the principles that we have, and to what degree is it more a problem of marketing?
I mean, it seems to me that I appreciate that in the last couple of iterations, the debates and maybe from the convention onward, there has been this sort of channeling and sort of almost like sort of they've sort of taken some of these positions, sort of this, you know, I think Donald Trump was making the case for trickle-down economics, or maybe Hillary was accusing him of being a trickle-down economics person in the debates. He has almost sort of become more Reagan-esque as the thing has progressed. I don't think it's what his instincts were, and I don't think it's where he started. I mean, he started as anti-trade. He started as build a wall. He started, and he still is, very pro-Russia. So that's not very Reagan. I don't think his instincts are very Reagan. I think it's, right? But, well, to the extent that it's changed, I mean, it's changed because of the influence of Reince Priebus and the RNC sort of becoming his campaign apparatus. I mean, I'm not sure if any of that's authentic. I don't think we know what Trump's policies are other than our relationship with Russia.
Russia
hasn't changed. I would argue Russia hasn't changed that much, other than the fact that they did lose the Soviet Union. I don't think when you have the former head of the KGB running Russia that sort of aspires to reestablish the Soviet Union, I think we're dealing with a very something that we should take a lot more seriously than Donald Trump does.
You know, one interesting thing about the issue positions that Trump has adopted, the standard conservative issue positions that he has, I think the pattern here is that he adopted a bunch of social conservative positions, but the issues where he still doesn't sound like a conventional Republican. He really doesn't talk all that much about shrinking government. He doesn't talk all that much about sort of the constitutionalist themes that previous Republicans have adopted. Sort of the limited government side of conservatism doesn't seem to be one that he felt he had to embrace in order to win the nomination or the general election.
When I first encountered Trump supporters, starting around August of last year, having been completely mystified by the phenomenon for about the first 2 months, as were all of my fellow pundits, the things that I heard from them when I asked them, and these are Trump supporters in New York, so they're probably a more sort of upscale urban type of Trump supporter than the stereotype. But the things I heard from them, you know, when I said, well, why do you support Trump? He's not politically correct, and he fights. And so I think that you are onto something in as much as you are suggesting that a large part of the appeal of Trump is that he has a confident and even belligerent attitude and doesn't sort of accept the assumptions of the dominant liberal culture. Aside from all the policy questions, on which I think the answer to your question is more mixed, but I think he's probably considerably less Reaganite in his policies than your question presupposes, but I think you're right about the attitude part.
We're past 5:40, but do we have time for one or two more, boss? I'm asking you, Lauren. What do you think? Should we go ahead? Do you want to meet this gentleman here?
Yeah.
And then this gentleman
yeah,
here,
just
please.
To build on that, I mean, we're talking about ideas and intellectual things, but I don't know if that's what moves most voters. To your point, when I talked to Trump supporters, it was an emotional matter. And the Democrats are a very emotional party. They're about caring and love. And they dominate the culture, as you point out, and they demagogue issues very, very effectively and not as violently or as grossly as Trump. Should not our party or should not the conservative side think about being more emotional and repackaging very effective Reagan-esque policies in an emotional package and not be the earnest party that's on the defensive, be on the offensive? And I think that's what appealed to people about Trump. Plus, the culture has changed, more of a celebrity culture. I have two teenage kids. They do not read the newspaper. They do not read books. They get things in instant communication, and they want things with a high emotional content, like Vice News. They're not interested in long-winded, old-fashioned political discussions. And I think the Democrats have captured on that very well, and our party has not. And if we continue to talk about ideas too much and be defensive, we will not win.
Although if you look at the two nominees, one of them is considerably more emotional than the other, and it's not Mrs. Clinton, which is not necessarily to say that the premise of your question is wrong, just to suggest that perhaps it's possible to go too far in that direction, and maybe if Trump were a little bit more in control of his emotions, he would do better.
Look, I mean, this is, you know, this is one of the many great challenges on anybody who's sort of from the center to the right on has. You know, the people who are most effective, at least communicating with the people who you refer to, your kids who are on Facebook and getting any of their news through their sort of Facebook streams or else they're watching John Oliver, because Jon Stewart's no longer on the air and Stephen Colbert is not funny anymore. Like that, you know, we need, you know, we don't actually have a lot of comedy. We don't have a lot of lightheartedness. We don't have a lot of creativity in packaging our ideas. I mean, this is, I think, again, one of the reasons we always hearken back to Reagan, right? Because he was one of these transcendent communicators who was able to animate the imagination of people who didn't self-identify as Republicans and then began to. And that's, you know, that's where we just sit around and wait for the second coming. But I think it's a worthy point. You raise a worthy point. We don't have a lot of creativity in terms of how we disseminate what we think are superior ideas.
I'd just be long-winded and old-fashioned, so that's pretty much my market.
So. First of all, I wished I'd said that. We've heard a lot from this panel and a bit from previous panels that the Republican Party, to win, must appeal to the non-college-educated white nationalist worker. But I haven't heard anything about specific policies that the Republican Party could adopt to appeal to that group. Do you have any?
Well, I certainly don't have a foolproof formula there. It does seem to me that a couple things. One, it does seem to me that if you think about the sort of the places where Trump has marked out territory that is distinctive on issues, immigration, trade, foreign policy, entitlements, immigration is the place where I think he's got the strongest case. And where the working class nationalist segment of the party has the kernel of a reasonable point that ought to be accommodated. So, for example, the 2013 immigration bill that got 68 votes in the Senate involved a doubling of legal immigration levels. Much of that would have been an increase in low-skilled immigration. That seems to me to be a bad idea. I don't know what the national problem to which doubling immigration levels, much of it unskilled, is the solution. That doesn't mean you have to build a wall necessarily. It shouldn't mean that you deport all illegal immigrants here. I wouldn't even rule out the possibility of an eventual amnesty after you have made it clear that the laws are going to be enforced at the border and the workplace. But that, it seems to me, is something that needs to change in the Republican Party. I think the comprehensive immigration reform, at least as it has previously been conceived, needs to be off the table. So that's one piece of it, and I think it's an important piece of it. But beyond that, I think that there are a whole range of issues where conservatives need to kind of get in the game. We have a set of very bad healthcare policies. We've had bad healthcare policies since before Obamacare came around. I think we can apply conservative insights to this issue in a way that'll solve a lot of people's problems with high prices, with portability. I think our higher education policies are generating more and more problems and more anxiety for a lot of middle-class parents. Again, these policies, while they're not exactly liberal policies, they reflect more liberal big government assumptions than they do our conservative assumptions. But conservatives have not been in the game. They haven't been talking about these things. They haven't been thinking about these things. That is starting to change, but it seems to me that there's a whole range of issues that for decades we spent not talking about. We should come up with our own conservative agenda and start selling it. And you're not going to get everybody, but I think you are going to be able to make an appeal. Some of the issue positions are going to be attractive, and just the mere fact that you seem to be a solution-oriented, future-oriented party is also going to change and improve, I think, your image.
But I think, you know, what Ramesh gets to is that there is sort of a dearth of new products out there, sort of policy products out there on the right. You know, or people more basically just like, we don't have new ideas. We haven't had, I mean, there have been some, and I think what Ramesh and, you know, many on the right have begun to do is sort of outline the contours of what sort of a new intellectual conservative movement could look like. But it's, again, it's just, you're squint and you're beginning to see it. You know, you have people sort of on the social conservative side, I think of Pete Wehner and Mike Gerson, who wrote this lovely book, City of Man, about sort of social justice and sort of a new way for evangelicals to be, you know, both sort of moral leaders and politically viable. And these are, you know, products of the George W. Bush administration, but really feel that the socially conservative political part of the coalition has failed. So I think you have a lot of rethinking about all of this that is happening, but frankly, we need to put more sort of resources behind it, emphasis on it, and sort of drive into sort of putting our heads down and developing what sort of really the delineating what the policies are. And then, by the way, we have some policies that are great and we need to politicize more, like education reform, right? I mean, this is a very clear wedge issue that is a fantastic way to build our coalition to African American and Latino families who are clearly benefiting from like this. I mean, this is sort of a moral issue that Republicans have the high ground on, and I think we could do more to take advantage of that politically.
James, you have the last word.
I don't know. This seems, I mean, I don't necessarily disagree with any of the things my co-panelists just say, but it seems awfully wonky for an approach to politics. And I think we need to take into account also what this gentleman, the penultimate questioner, said. I mean, if a Democrat were asked that question, he would say something about health care for everyone and, need to take into account the marketing, the rhetoric, the selling of the proposals as well.
Thank you, everybody.